well, after this whole these 2 summers, I'm still thinking out loud that we're on. Great.
Hello.
So hello, everybody. And I think we start with Jamie.
I think we do. Officially this time.
Officially. At 13.1, chapter 13, the Soporific Well, which, if anybody cares, has been identified by some people as the island of St. Michael in the Azores, because that's where there's the bad spring. Someone's got a very strange sound on their computer.
That sort of humming, buzzing noise? I hear it, too.
Buzzing noise. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're on a motorcycle. Is anyone on a motorcycle? maybe try muting your microphones to see who's doing it. Maybe John, is that, could that be yours?
Yes.
Yeah, that went away. So John, I don't know what you're doing, but somehow your computer is making a really nasty noise. I don't mean to insult your computer. Nobody likes their computer insulted, but if you could figure, anyway, we'll deal with it. But if you can mute when you're not talking, that'd be great. But okay. Good. Jamie, take it away. 13.1.
Okay. Transactis festivitatibus, the festivities having passed, accepta annona et benedictione sanctorum virorum, the basically alms or doling out of food and blessing of the holy men having been accepted, beatus Brendanus cum suis sequacibus, the blessed Brendan with his followers, tetendit vela in oceanum navicule sue quantocius, spread out the sails of his little ship on the ocean as quickly as possible, presumably early in the ocean, when they got into the ocean and spread out the sails.
Mm-hmm.
Et sive per navigium, sive per vela, and whether by rowing or by sailing, ferebatur navis per diversa loca, the ship was carried through various places, usque in initium quadragesime, until the beginning of Lent.
Mm-hmm.
Quadam, yes. Were you saying?
I just said good. I'm just being encouraging.
Okay, sorry. I broke up for a moment. Quadam autem die, but on a certain day viderunt insulam a regione non longe ab illis. They saw an island in an area not far from them. Cum fratres illam vidicent, when the brothers had seen it, ceperunt acriter navigare, they began to sail eagerly, quia iam valde vexati erant fame et siti, because now they were much troubled by hunger and thirst. Ante triduum, 3 days before, enim...
Vexati erant?
They had been.
Yeah, they'd already been, right.
Mm-hmm.
They had already been much troubled by hunger and thirst. Ante triduum enim, for 3 days before, deficit victus et potus, the food and water ran out.
Yeah, that's a misprint on my part. It should be defecit, but it means the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, how nice.
Yeah.
At vero, but truly, cum sanctus pater benedicisset portum, when the Holy Father had blessed the port,
mm-hmm.
the harbor, et omnes existent foras de navi, and all had gone out of the ship in venerunt fontem lucidissimum, they saw a very clear, literally almost a very bright fountain, et herbas diversas, and various herbs, ac radices in circuitu fontis, and roots around the fountain, but not roots of a marvelous flavor.
No, ordinary ones.
Mm-hmm, just roots. Diversaque genera piscium, and various sorts of fish, discurrentes per alveum in mare, swimming through the current in the sea. No, I really don't know what alveum is, I'm afraid.
Riverbed.
Riverbed.
The riverbed.
I knew I recognized the word, but I couldn't.
I meant to gloss that. I think we may have had it before, but it was long ago enough that I had to look it up again. I'll gloss it again.
Okay. I feel better for not knowing it.
Good, thank you.
Running or basically swimming, I mean, that's how what they would be doing, their fish in water. Swimming through the channel, by the channel, down through the channel into the sea.
Right, so they're river fish going
in the sea.
Down to the sea. Right. Makes sense, right. Like salmon.
It makes sense, but is discurrenting, it isn't actually going with anything?
Oh, yeah.
Genera, I guess.
Yeah, those can't go together. I mean, obviously,
yeah, they couldn't, but that's kind of what he wants it to. Well, he really wants it to go with fish.
Right.
He wants to go with Piscase, right.
Right. Is Constructio ad sensum, would you buy that, Jen? Right? I mean they do that.
I think we have a visitor whose camera does not appear to be working.
Well, grainy. True. But that, yeah, well, we'll deal with that, see who it is. It's exciting. Discurrent, I mean, you're right. I had totally hadn't noticed that.
What the fuck? Why did that picture show up?
He's gone away. I think I can block people, but wow, that seems so...
Yeah.
It's like somebody got on the wrong wavelength.
So judgmental. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we could have made well, somebody game. Comes into our chat who doesn't belong here and starts cussing.
Right.
The least that he could have said was a costor or something
right.
like that.
We'll make him translate if he comes back.
Right.
Constructio ad sensum, that's a thing, right? Jen, you're not happy with it.
I don't know. I don't like it. It's so... It just looks like such an error to me.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. Although you get the sense out of it, I have a question mark by it, like, y'all, those. Where's right. the map being set? It needs to modify something?
Well, it's modified. I mean, piscium implies piscase.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, how should it be set up in order to work?
I guess I should agree with genera.
Well, the thing is, if it agrees with anything, like, if it is grammatical, it has to agree with the subject
mm-hmm.
of Inwe Nairun. They found it, and they found it when they were running along the channel into the sea.
Into the sea.
But it makes much more sense for the fish to do it, except the fish don't run, either.
Right. Well, wait, I have something that might make sense. If you take alveum in mare to be a phrase, if in mare is describing alveum, if it's the channel into the sea, if that's how we're describing the channel, then the monks could be running along the channel. Like, if we say this, there is a channel into the sea. The monks were running along it and saw all these things. It doesn't right. make a lot of sense, but it could work grammatically.
It could work grammatically. But couldn't discurrentes could also be accusative plural?
It could be, but then it would be the wrong gender.
Right.
There's nothing to agree with.
Right, but then we're back. Then we circle back to constructio ad sensum, picking up piscase.
But per alveum means through the channel, doesn't it?
Yes.
It's coming along.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, it does. I think Jamie's solution is brilliant, but implausible.
Yes. I mean, if this were something that I had already been told was correct Latin, perfectly correct Latin, and I had to figure out the sense hidden in it, that's what I would do.
Right.
But as it is, I'm more inclined to say this is something I would write, possibly, or something that a better Latinist than I would write if you were a bit tired.
Well, in general, Jamie, you can't have a prepositional phrase that modifies a noun in Latin. It's not that it's ungrammatical, but it's very rare.
Yes,
men in the castle construction, because in English you would say the men in the castle poured boiling oil on their enemies. But in right. Latin you wouldn't say that. You would say the men who were in the castle. You do not like prepositions dangling off nouns. Now that's not to say that that doesn't happen in medieval Latin.
Right.
And I think in either case, whether it's the fish or the monks, they're running through the channel into the sea. And it doesn't necessarily, like, whether they're moving or the channel's moving, it's the same thing.
Right.
If it helps, so there's this translation by John O'Meara, who is a very distinguished Latinist. In fact, I think he writes on Aquinas and those guys. He translates them as fish swimming along the riverbed into the sea. So that's at least how...
That would be constructio ad sensum.
It has to be something like that, yes. But yeah, as I said...
There really doesn't seem to be any best solution. No. All of them suppose something weird.
Yeah. All right, keep going, Jamie.
It's a weird passage.
Mm-hmm.
Sanctus Brendanus fratribus suis ait. St. Brendan said to his brothers, Deus dedit nobis hic consolationem post laborem. God gave to us this consolation or this comfort after labor.
Look at hic again.
Here.
Right.
He gave us here.
Yeah, it can't go with consolation.
Mm-hmm. He gave us here comfort after work.
Good.
Accipite pices, receive, or I suppose catch, the fish, quantum sufficit ad nostram chenam, enough, as much as is enough for our supper, or our dinner, our meal, aque assate eos igni, and roast them by means of fire,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to all the other ways to roast things.
Right.
Colligite herbas et radices, collect the herbs and roots, or the plants and roots, quas dominus servis suis preparavit, which the Lord prepared for his servants.
So it's a perfectly balanced meal. It's a protein, a starch, and a salad.
Mm-hmm.
Good point.
Nice. Et ita fecerunt, and they did so. They did thus. Cum autem effudissent aguam ad bibendum, but when they had drawn water to drink, water for drinking, dixit eis virdei, the man of God said to them, Fratres, cave te ne supra modum utamini his aquis. Brothers, take care lest you use these waters more than the modum, more than moderately,
yeah.
would be probably the best English.
Mm-hmm.
Ne gravius vexentur corpora vestra, lest your bodies be severely troubled. At vero, but actually, fratres...
Hyperthyroid. I saw that today because I think I have anxiety. You can use it with hyperthyroid. What happens is your eyes come out of the area they're supposed to.
I'm injecting him.
You see, your symptoms are dry out.
Yay.
Thank you.
Fun. I apologize to whoever it was if he was a legitimate entrant. But as you say, he already blotted his copybook with his language, which, of course, is very
unscholarly.
It's nefas.
Un-internet-y, right? All right, keep going, Jamie.
At vero, but truly, or but actually, fratres inequaliter definitionem viri dei considerabant, the brothers didn't consider equally, or that they considered unequally, they thought differently about the pronouncement of the man of God, et alii singulos calices bibebant, and some drank one cup, alii binos, some two, ceteri namque eternos, but to be sure the rest, three, inquos iruit, on whom, that is the rest that drank three, there came sopor trium dierum et noctium, a sleep of 3 days and nights, in alios quoque duorum dierum et noctium, in the others, that is the second ones, onto the second ones there came a sleep came of 2 days and nights, in reliquos vero unius die et noctis, and on the rest, truly, or but on the rest of 1 day and night.
Good.
At Sanctus Pater, sine intermissione deprecabatur Dominum pro fratribus suis, But the Holy Father, without a pause, without a break, interceded with the Lord for his brothers. Quod per ignorantiam contigit illes tale periculum. That because by ignorance such a danger came upon them.
Good. Did you catch that in the second to last line, second to last sentence? You basically have a three-pronged chiasmus, right? An A, B, C, B, B, A construction, which is very exciting, right?
It's fascinating, and it's something you couldn't do in English. No one would understand which you meant.
I guess not. You'd get all confused with your pronouns, wouldn't you? Good. And presumably that's all somehow spiritual and symbolic, right?
Well, it reminds me of a couple of things. Well, for one thing, it reminds me of the Island of the Lotus Eaters in the Odyssey, and being another sea journey story. Mm-hmm. And it also reminds me of certain incidents in the Pilgrim's Progress. There was a place where it looked very restful, and Christian lay down to sleep, but when he was sleeping there, when he should have been going on, he lost the scroll that was going to be his passport into the Celestial City, and he had to go back and get it and lost a lot of time.
You know, I'm some...
So that was a sleeping... And that had spiritual significance of it being the sin of sloth that he was committing.
Isn't sleeping a thing that's... the story of the seven sleepers.
Yeah.
Very popular.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
They slept longer, of course.
They slept longer. Here, I mean, here obviously it's the most obvious thing is Jesus, right? You know, sleeping 3 days, as it were. But there's no analog for the two one.
This appears to be different because what's going on here is what reminded me of the Pilgrim's Progress was that the sleep is a disaster for them.
Yeah.
Apparently, because Brendan has to pray for them morning, noon, and night while they're sleeping.
Right.
It's a danger, and it's apparently very bad.
Right. I'm very impressed that you've read the Pilgrim's Progress. I've never been able to finish it. I can't read books like that. I can't stand all that symbolism. It gets me down.
I love it.
Great. You're a better person than I am. We got to talk college at some point. I don't know what's happening. Thank you, Jamie. I don't know what's happening now. Has anyone signed up for the next chunk?
Yes, Bert.
Bert, is that you? I didn't think so. I think Bert's the second, the chunk after this, isn't he?
Yeah, Bert? I think I'm the chunk after this.
Okay.
I'm sorry, yes.
So do we want to volunteer for 13.4, or is somebody else, John, have you or Jen signed up for that?
No, they signed up for others.
Jen, do you want to try it? You're doing a different...
No problem.
Okay.
Thank you.
So that's 13.4, right?
Yeah.
All right. So indeed, with these 3 days having been spent, having passed, the Holy Father said to his comrades, "Brothers, let us flee this death, lest a worse thing happen to us. For the Lord has given us food, and from it, Inde, thence, you have made a loss, a ruin. Go out, therefore, outside from this island, and receive supplies, provisions from those fishes, take provisions from those fishes, and prepare as much as is necessary for a 3-day period all the way to Maundy Thursday."
We need to be specific about the 3-day period, right? They need a food so they can eat every 3 days until Maundy Thursday, because we're only right at the beginning of Lent.
Mm-hmm. That would make much more sense with pear. Yeah. Similarly, Akipite again, I guess, collect some water, some single chalices of water for the brothers for each day,
mm-hmm.
and equally from the roots. However, when they were loading the ships, or the ship,
mm-hmm.
from all the things which the man of God had ordered them, is it like they were loading the ship with the things?
That's how I, okay. I'm going to add a gloss. I take it that that's the equivalent of an ablative of means.
Yes.
Okay. So, but when they were loading the ship with all the things which the man of God had ordered them to, they stretched forth their sails, and they began to sail onto the ocean in the northern direction.
Good. Keep going.
Furthermore, after 3 days and nights, the wind ceased, and the sea began to be, as it were, coagulated,
mm-hmm.
hardened together, on account of its excessive tranquility. Its excessive calmness. The Holy Father said, put down the oars into the boat and loosen the sails, relax the sails. Wherever God wants to direct the boat, let him do it. Therefore, the boat was being carried for around 20 days. After these things, Again, God raised the wind, a prosperous wind for them, a wind that was coming from the west toward the east.
Mm-hmm.
Then, at the same time, they began to stretch their sails into the deep and sail.
Stretch their sails into the deep?
Like they're stretching their sails and they're sailing like out onto the ocean.
I think it's also possible that altum here means height. That they're stretching the sails into the sky.
That would have been my interpretation. I mean, I see the note, but can't it mean either?
Yeah.
Yeah, I took it. The reason I thought that it was the sea was that we've had that tendere vela in mare.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And that altum certainly is a regular, at least in classical Latin, regularly a synonym for the sea, you know, out onto the deep.
I wouldn't have thought it could mean into a height, but...
Oh, it does classically as well. Okay. That's not a, that one's not unusual. I'm not, I gotta say, I'm not used, in medieval Latin, I don't know how much I've seen of altum for deep. I'm used to seeing it for height, and that just may be what I've been reading recently, but...
Well, honestly, taking it somewhat differently, it would make equal sense either way.
Oh,
yeah,
sure.
I think so. Yeah.
Yes, we're arguing about something that matters even less than most of the things we argue about. But
which takes some doing. That's an achievement.
Right.
Really.
But except that it's interesting.
Fascinating. I want to know, too. That doesn't make it relevant.
Right. I'll look up altum in a medieval dictionary. I certainly didn't pursue it. I was just thinking, this is what happens. And Bruce catches me on this all the time, is I think like a classicist, and that's just wrong some of the time. Good. In case anyone cares, people have identified this dead space in the ocean with the Sargasso Sea. Though rereading it, it strikes me that there's no mention of weeds, which seems kind of disappointing if you're looking for this kind of thing. But it's just a dead spot in the ocean, and
It's interesting that in that documentary you referred to us about the crazy guys who went across the Atlantic in a skin boat, they got becalmed at one point, And they basically just went right around in a circle. Greenland.
You know, maybe we can be really conspiracy theorists and say that this is the Bermuda Triangle.
Mm. Wait, tell me where they set off from again.
In the first place?
Yeah, well, I was just thinking the Bermuda Triangle seems like a long way to get.
Yeah, no, they're not there yet.
Oh, yes.
No, this is on the theory that they were in the Azores and now they're in the Sargasso Sea, but who knows how. I mean, there are a number of eccentric people who have written books on this subject with interesting backgrounds.
There's more than one region in the Atlantic where ships... I wouldn't say that they say that in the Bermuda Triangle, considering the traffic, there isn't really any higher percentage of ships that are lost over the time period they talk about. However, there are other parts along the coast of North America where planes and ships have difficulty. They're either because of the way the shore is or the way the atmospheric conditions tend to be, it's really easy to get lost.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those areas is actually just south of Long Island.
Oh.
Really?
Yeah.
Two things that come from YouTube. First of all, Karen Ruff says, you see in altum, meaning the deep, all the time in medieval Latin as well, which doesn't help us. It really looks like it's a toss-up. And somebody wonders if the water is, that we're going back to the soporific well. Somebody wonders, Robert Budner wonders if the water is a spiritual substance and the monks who are not ready to imbibe it are, so to speak, asleep to such things.
That's an interesting...
I think is very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting theory.
Yeah.
That could work.
See, now that's deep.
But not in altum, not necessarily.
Going back to the sea, I just wanted to say all they are is becalmed, right? They're not disappearing. It's nothing that mysterious. They're just becalmed in the middle of the ocean for a long time. Because it doesn't even... Well, it does say that the sea is coagulatum. And I guess that's what gives you the sense of the Sargasso.
Sargasso, yeah.
So maybe I was wronging those people. So that's good. I'd like it to be the Sargasso Sea. I like saying the word. Okay. Chapter 15. Thank you, Jen. That was terrific. So Bert, chapter 15?
Yeah.
Okay, take it away.
All right. So indeed, on a certain day, an island appeared to them from far off, likely clouds.
Bert, can you turn up your microphone or something, or do something clever? Or possibly just move closer to the microphone?
Does that work better?
Yeah, that's better, yeah.
Okay. On a certain day, an island appeared to them from far off as if a cloud. And St. Brendan said, "My little sons, do you know this island?" But they said, "Nope." But he said, "I know it."
The cognosco here, I think this might be just like nosco and noscare, just a compound. So we're really, I think what he's really saying is, do you recognize this island?
Mm-hmm.
Does that sound right?
Yeah. I guess he said no, but this is... Sorry, recognize, I guess, is a better... I didn't think about that. Recognize, I think, is probably better than no, but it's clear it means the same thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Good.
So this is... For this is that very island on which we were last year on Holy Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
Where our good procurator lived, or lives.
Mm-hmm.
Then the brothers began to sail eagerly out of joy, as much as their strength could sustain them, or as long as the men were able to sustain their strength.
Mm-hmm. As long as the strength were as long as their strength. Remember, Wires is strengths and Wiri is men. So as long as their strengths could sustain them.
And when the man of God had seen these things, he said, don't tire out your limbs from stupidity. surely God, all-powerful God, is the steerer and the captain of our little ship. Hand it over to him, because he directs our way just as he wishes.
Good.
You know, it just keeps striking me. An amazing number of things happened to these guys. If I were one of them, I would have been saying a long time ago, okay, which way is Ireland and how soon can we get there?
Mm-hmm. All right. And when they had approached to the shore of the aforementioned island, the same procurator came out to meet them in the ship?
I think so, yeah.
Or was he in his own little boat?
In his own little boat. Mm-hmm. So he came out to meet them in his own little boat, and he led them to the port where the previous year they had gotten off the ship, glorifying God and kissing the feet of each one of them. Beginning with the Holy Father and going all the way up until the very last one, saying, God is, here it says terrible, God is terrible in his holy places. The God of Israel himself will give virtue and fortitude to his people. Mm-hmm. Blessed be God. And now, having finished with the versicle, and with everyone having gotten off of the ship, he set up a tent and prepared a bath, for it had been, or it was Holy Thursday, and he clothed all the brothers with new clothes, and he did service to them, basically, for the 3 days, for the Holy Week.
Good.
And the brothers also were celebrating the Passion of the Lord with great diligence up until Holy Saturday.
Good. A couple of detailed things. In line 3, incipiens a sancto patre usque ad novissimum, I glossed Novissimus as last, and I think that was stupid, because obviously he would have kept going until the last one. That's kind of redundant. I think Novissimus just means the youngest, so he went.
Actually, I think you were right. In the Benedictine tradition, at least, and it's not clear to us, you know, to what extent the author here is thinking of the Benedictine tradition, people have rank in the monastery according to when they entered.
Ah.
Not their age or anything else, but when they entered.
Ah, so seniority.
So if someone who's 20 years old enters on Thursday afternoon, and someone who's 45 enters on Thursday evening, it's seniority. So novissimum does literally mean the newest or the latest, but also in that sense, the last.
Mm-hmm.
This is, of course, where we get the word novice, meaning somebody who's new at something.
Right. Mm-hmm. Good. But it's not the last in the series of feet that he kisses, which is sort of what. So anyway.
I took it to mean just the last of the least senior of the group.
Right. Okay, that's great. Thank you. The third line from the bottom, omnibus ablatis de navibus.
Yes.
Can't mean everybody gets out, because it means with everything got taken off, with everything having been removed from the ship. In other words, they unloaded the stuff. This is this fundamental problem with so many forms that you can't tell if we're talking about people or things. It's so annoying, right? If it were omnes, you'd know it was humans, probably, right? Omnia is clearly things. Go into the ablative, and we don't have that information anymore, and we're on our own. It's just so annoying. And then finally, and this is something we're going to see later, the extended tentorium. I don't know what you think, Bruce, but it seems like this is another case where, as with sending the sails into the ship just means setting the boat off, you're not thinking really about sails. You're not really thinking about tents. You're just kind of preparing a place to sleep.
It's like they like making camp, which
right.
can include any number of shelters or none.
Right. I mean, the idea that, because at one point, I guess it's here, you know, you'd have to believe that he had a special, like, guest tents ready for them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? Which just doesn't seem very, it would seem very organized, right?
Yeah. I mean, when they were pitching tents in the Gesta Francorum, they were pitching tents.
Those were tents, right. But this, I think, is just, I only thought of that just this afternoon.
That's a good point.
That this just has to be, like, prepare a house for them.
Prepare a shelter or something.
Shelter, a habitation.
Excellent.
Anything else, anybody?
Sorry, we could back in 15.1. It seems like there's a little bit of trouble translating sostenere in that phrase about quantum vires aeorum patrerunt sostenere. You could translate it as something like as long as their strength was able to hold out. Because I don't think you supply Eos with it, like to hold them up. I think it's actually as long as their strength was able to hold out.
Was able to bear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sustinere, I guess, is usually transitive, and it may just be intransitive here.
Right. Yeah. Okay, great. Do we have someone for the next section?
I think that's me.
Oh, okay. John.
Good. Yeah. You can do noise.
I'm sorry? So we're at 15.3.
Do you still hear the problem with the noise that you had before?
Only slightly. But no. It's not so bad when you're the one talking anyways.
Okay, because I think it's my fan. I think the Google Hangout is really giving my computer a beating.
Yeah.
Is this the orders in the sense of like a monastic rite that we were talking about in previous weeks?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The prayer services, yeah.
So with the orders having been finished of the Sabbath day, and with spiritual sacrifices offered to God, and with the dinner or the feast having been finished, the same steward said to St. Brendan and to those who are with him, set out and ascend your ship so that you may celebrate Holy Sunday, the Night of the Resurrection, where you celebrated it last year, and also the day, similarly, up to the sixth hour. Afterward, sail to the island, which is called the Paradise of Birds, where you were in the previous year, from Easter all the way to the 8th of Pentecost. Mm-hmm. And carry with you all the things which are necessary of food and drink. And then I will visit you on the following Sunday. And so and thus they did. And for he himself loaded the ship with breads and drink and meats and other delights, however as many as they were able to take. And St. Brendan, with the blessing having been given, ascended into the ship and began immediately to sail to the other island.
Great. I just textual note here. I love how, you know, they're on an island with their procurator, and he says, Now go so you can celebrate the Easter vigil where you did last year, and then go on from there to the Island of Birds. What he fails to say is, go get on the whale again.
Yeah, that cracks me up. It's like, where you spent it last year, we won't go into details.
Yeah. And we don't need to talk more about that.
But he's quite specific about it. It's somewhere else. Have we either seen that, either we've seen it already or it's coming? He says, you know, you're going to, every Easter you're going to be on Jeskon.
Mm-hmm. He does say it later on, right.
And previously.
Right.
And I just love that the whale has a name.
Right.
It's Jeskonius. It makes me laugh every time. Not sure why.
I just have a quick question about meat, because as far as I know, monks don't eat meat. I know that we've seen meat before, like on Jeskonius, but is there anything about when monks stopped eating meat because it was only in the East, or?
I think it sort of depends from tradition to tradition. Again, the one I know is the Benedictines, and they generally aren't supposed to eat meat unless they're sick. But we're in an unusual situation here, you know?
Yeah, they're in a fair way to be sick if they're not.
They're certainly going to eat whale meat by the end of the evening. And,
yeah, but of course they think that's fish, right?
That's true.
Also, Ireland has a big culture. During this time, Ireland is big on beef.
Right. And I think later on we discover that Brendan himself is a committed vegetarian, but that makes him separate and distinct from the others. But I think it's a good point, because we haven't actually seen any real meat at all, have we?
Jeskonius, I think, they're putting meat. Yeah.
Well, birds.
But the whale meat... Mm-hmm. is referred to as meat. So
right.
I wonder if we have it could be also that we have a very capacious idea of meat, which is it's something off a dead animal.
Right, that makes sense.
Because whales are definitely considered fish at this time.
Right.
Right. In fact, I believe they've referred to Jeskonius as a fish.
Right. I didn't remember they used the word meat in related. I just remember that they ate it.
But, related to the whale tail.
Right, but that makes perfect sense that the carnivus would be the fish that we've been talking about all the last couple of chapters. So it's a good question, John. Do you want to keep going, John? 15.4. He's frozen, maybe?
Yeah, maybe.
He looks frozen.
Or he's very quiet.
I think he's frozen.
This is such a weird experience.
It's like shouting into the...
I think my connection's getting a little...
Okay.
I think there are problems with my connection. I can't
hear
you guys a lot either.
Do you want to try? Okay, do you want to try it, John? Or not? Maybe we should just go on. Anyone need to have a volunteer then?
I'll do it.
Okay.
Cum autem apropin quasent ad locum ubi ascendere debuisent de navi. But when they had approached to the place where they ought to have gotten on the ship, the boat, ecce apparuit illis cacabus, quem altero anno dimiserunt. Behold, there appeared to them the... I have no idea what this is, and I don't remember from previously. The what?
Cooking pot.
You know, we've had it already, and I had to go look it up again, and I wrote William saying you should gloss this, but he's already glossed it once.
I know, so
that one just completely went by me.
Because I'm a hard man. I said I glossed it once. I'm not glossing it again. But then I'm glossing. I'll gloss it again. I promise.
The cooking pot appeared to them, which the year before they had left.
Yep.
They had sent away.
Uh-huh.
They abandoned it on the back of the whale.
Right.
Oh yes, on the back of the whale. That's right, because they lit the whale on fire and freaked out.
Yes.
Poor whale.
Sorry, the whole whale thing just makes me laugh. Tunc Sanctus Brendanus ascendens de Navi, then St. Brendan getting out of the ship. This is getting out now, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes. Cum suis fratribus with his brothers, cepit cantare imnum trium puerorum usque in finem, began to sing the hymn of the three boys, or the three children, all the way to the end. Finito autem predicto imno, the aforementioned hymn having been finished, virde admonebat suos fratres, the man of God admonished or warned his brothers, dicens, saying, O filioli, vigilate et orate, O little sons, keep watch and pray, ut non intretis in temptationem, in order that you may not enter into temptation. Considerate quo modo subjugat Deus in manissimam bestiam subtus nos sine ullo impedimento. Consider how God subdues this enormous beast below us without any obstacle, without any inconvenience.
It's that whale again.
Yeah.
The whale again.
Can someone tell me, I don't remember temptation in this text before. Why is it especially, why are you especially liable to give in to temptation when you're hanging out on the back of the whale in the middle of the night?
I guess maybe the temptation is for them to think, we're so awesome, we ride on whales. So he's warning
or
them.
Or maybe the temptation is to nap.
So he's warning them to think about how God subdues the whale. That's all I'm thinking. It's maybe
like, I think that's plausible.
Yeah, the second point, I think Jamie's right, the second point seems to me what's important. In other words, think about how God subdues the whale. That's a really good lesson. Mm-hmm.
Which, of course, is stuff from the book of Job, partially.
Right.
Or Jonah.
Yeah, where is Job or Jonah?
Job. Well, Jonah as well, of course, Jonah and the whale, but there's a long passage in Job about, you know, the Leviathan, the creature of the deep,
right.
How God controls it and man can't.
Right. So the answer to Bruce's question is that that's really just a setup. It's just anytime you're going to draw a lesson about God's power, you set it up by saying, be sure not to enter in temptation.
Right.
Rather than thinking there's any particular temptation on the back of the whale. I'm just thinking out loud what we've already been saying. Is that what we all think?
That makes sense. He's just basically setting them up for a sermon.
Right, right. It's a good point, though, Jim.
How Baptist of him.
Okay, Paul, are you ready to take over? Thank you, Jamie.
Yep.
No problem.
Okay, 15:5. The brothers then held a vigil here and there through that island. Are we on the whale again? Is that what we're... I wasn't really entirely clear about that.
It's a very big whale.
Okay. Through that island until the morning vigils. Thereafter, all the priests offered individual masses until the third hour, which would be 9 o'clock in the morning.
Mm.
Thence the blessed Brendan burned an immaculate lamb to God, and I see your note asking if this is figurative.
Probably.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you never know. They did some weird things back then in the north. And said to the brothers, in another year here we have the resurrection of the Lord. Thus I wasn't entirely sure about this. Thus I wish, in this year?
Yeah, I think altero anno means last year, so I want to do the same thing this year.
Right.
Okay.
Right, so the even, really. Thus I want, also in this year, even in this year.
Okay, so we did it last year, let's do it this year.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And thence they proceeded to the island of the birds.
Good. Could I ask about the omnes sacerdotes?
I wasn't entirely sure what was going on in that passage.
Well, why are some of the brothers priests and some not priests?
That's
possible.
That wouldn't
be uncommon.
Yeah?
It's actually more common later on,
mm-hmm.
When the abbots lose power to the priests, and you need a priest to take Mass.
Sure.
The abbot is not, for example, able to receive confession and give absolution by the 12th century or 13th century, really.
You mean because the abbot's not a priest?
The abbot's not usually a priest.
Oh, okay.
Certainly not necessarily.
It's one of the things that got the Templars, it's one of the things they used to accuse the Templars, although Templar historians believe that they were relatively, they were pretty uneducated for monks. Mm. And so they believe that they weren't being deliberately heretical, they simply weren't aware that things had changed. Mm. Because when they were founded early in the 12th century, it was still okay for, say, the head of a chapter house to take confession and give absolution, even though they had priests serving at chapter houses for that purpose. But in this time period, at any time period, you're going to have a mix of priests and monks. They're not one and the same.
No, I know that. It was weird because they've been fratres all this time, and suddenly we learn that
they break out into priests.
Yeah.
Didn't they mention priests in last week's? I thought we had a passage that was discussing priests.
Oh, maybe.
Maybe they did, and it just didn't strike us funny at the time.
Okay, well, I'm glad you solved that. That's great. 15.6, do you want to keep going?
Something every day.
Sure.
Before we go on, I maybe my theology is deficient here. What would it mean if you figuratively sacrifice a lamb?
That would be the Eucharist.
Yeah, that would be Holy
the Eucharist.
Okay.
The body of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
While we're on this subject, I somehow missed, because my audio is going in and out, those at the beginning of 15.3, those immolatis victimis spiritualibus.
Mm, right.
Karen points out that you would not have communion on Holy Saturday until Easter Vigil.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
this early though?
So that makes it a real sheep?
No, I don't think it makes it a real sheep either.
Not necessarily. Because the book Medieval Monasticism has a note early on in which he talks about the dangers of syncretism around the 4th, 5th century in Northern Europe. And one example he gives is of a Germanic tribe that once they were converted from paganism, went straight from sacrificing bulls to Odin to sacrificing bulls to Christ. So it's not, we assume that St. Brendan is as orthodox as people in Rome at this period, but I'm not sure we absolutely have proof to that effect.
Mm-hmm.
But doesn't the beginning of, if you go back to the beginning of 15.3, doesn't that just mean they conducted, it seems to be consistent with what Karen's saying, they did all the hymn singing on the day, on the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
When that was over, right, then they had mm-hmm. Holy Communion. Imolatus victimis spiritualis Deo.
But her point is that you wouldn't do that until Easter Vigil on a Saturday, on a Holy Saturday night.
But don't we just assume that that's the time we're talking about?
No, because
they were having
first
Easter
you do
Vigil.
The prayers, then you do these, then you do this immolation, then you have supper.
But this is the practice that they're engaging in at this period of time in Ireland.
Which practice?
The practice of holding the vigil. I mean, we have to be careful because it's really easy to put what we think they're doing. If it seems really similar, to put what we think they're doing on what they're actually doing. Like, for example, we're assuming that they didn't actually sacrifice the lamb. And that's a good theory, but we don't have absolute proof to that respect. I mean, it's yeah. a pretty confused time.
In this case, I just wonder where they got one.
Well, there's that.
Also, I mean, I think the one thing that Immolatis Victimis Spiritualibus tells us is that the language of that immolavit, which we get in 15:5, it's clearly spiritual in 15:3, so it's all the more reason to think it's spiritual in 15:5, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, it makes sense.
Right. So that part, that seems to me, that clarifies that problem, I think, very nicely, mm-hmm. right? Because mm-hmm. they're victimis spiritualibus. Then there's the question of Karen's point about the timing of Holy Saturday, which I had no idea about, and I have no idea about. And if
what are we doing? Is that vigil in this time period?
I don't know.
I think this is still the period where there's a big divergence between what the Irish are doing and what Rome's doing. You know, the Easter controversy?
Well, wait a minute. Wait. Couldn't Cana Consumata also be figurative? In other words, they did their devotions on Saturday,
mm-hmm.
and they had Mass in the evening, which is what Karen says they should be doing, and mm-hmm. that's what Immolatis quae victimis spiritualibus Deo and means, and then Cana Consumata means, and after they'd had Holy Communion, right, as opposed to having,
mm-hmm.
right, so the Cana yeah. is the communion, then all you've got is a Holy Communion, which could be at the end of the day, which is at the end of the day, finitis ordinibus Dei Sabbati.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If Karen's listening, she can...
But of course, the whole doctrine of transubstantiation would say that confusion there is maybe just normal to feel because they regard the Eucharist as the living sacrifice.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. All right. Let's pencil that in as a possible solution, but or more importantly, I guess, a possible problem.
We have probably just lost all our viewers, all seven of them.
Oh no, still there.
And I mean, and are they using bread and wine as the communion, or are they using lamb jerky from Ireland? I don't know.
Lamb jerky.
And torching it a little bit and saying, "Here you go." It's the body of the lamb. I don't know. I think you're probably right that it's a celebration of the Mass.
Mm-hmm.
But there have been significant changes over the past 2,000 years on how people do things that seem it's easy to miss the nuances because they look familiar when you're reading about them because they don't give a whole lot of details about it. But then if you look at other sources, you start to see, oh, there's some significant differences here. So, I mean, these are guys hanging out on the back of a whale. They're doing some weird things in this story. And we haven't gotten to Judas yet. I mean,
All right, on that, where are we now? I've lost the point.
Did 15, 15, 7.
15,
oh, 15, 7, sorry. 15, no, we're, no, 15,
no, 15, 6. 15, 6.
Okay.
Okay.
I just look at things.
All right. But they, having drawn nigh to the port destination, door of the destination of this island.
Well, the intended port, the destined port, the port.
The destined port. Okay, I wasn't sure if that. Yeah. Okay.
The perfect participle.
If that was supposed to be a noun or an adjective.
The participle.
Okay. All of the birds sang as if with one voice, saying, "Good health to our God, sitting on a throne, and to the Lamb." And I did see the note before. I just kind of like the good health thing. And of other things, or on other things, concerning other things, Lord God, shine on us, build a solemn day in the groves. I know the note says with festal branches, but I'll say something in a minute about that. Even until the horn of the altar. Okay, I'm not sure what they meant by the horn of the altar.
Since Old Testament.
The what?
Yes, that's Old Testament language for just the altar part of the altar, I gather.
Right.
Okay.
Come across it frequently.
Yeah, okay. When I was talking about with the festal branches, groves is not necessarily a bad translation. When you consider, you know, the yew groves.
The what?
Of the British Isles.
The what?
That you have the groves, the ancient groves. The Romans cut down a lot of them, but entirely.
Paula, we know what the text is trying to say because it's from the Bible.
Yeah, this is biblical.
Right? It's Psalm, what is it? I've got it here. Psalm 118. Right?
God is the Lord. Yeah.
Showed us, like, bind the sacrifice.
Bind the sacrifice with cords, okay.
Right. So, basically, once we know we're dealing with the Old Testament, mm-hmm. kind of all bets are off, right? And
right.
We know how to figure out what that means, usually.
Right.
Usually. Before we go on, a more detailed note, just, again, Latin teachery notes. Cantabant.
They were singing.
And I only want to stress this partly because I have made a fool of myself steadily for years getting the tenses wrong. But when I get them right, I get very happy because it is different. All the birds were singing is more vivid than all the birds sang, right? It's just different. And it's one thing that Latin can do. I mean, English can do it too, but it's fundamental to Latin. So it's always worth remembering to try and test yourself on verb forms.
I knew it was imperfect. They were obviously singing at the same time that they were coming into the port.
Right. I know. It's more a matter of just bringing out that imperfectness. Also, this is just the et iterum in line 2.
Mm-hmm.
That means again. Right, and
again. Okay.
Right. Okay, so we're back to Tom Walkabus.
Okay. Let me scroll down a little bit here. With such voices that others resonated all day, not too sure about that.
Tom and Quam. Is one way of saying both with one thing and with another thing. So both with voices and with wings.
Oh, okay.
That's Alice, not Alice.
Right.
Okay. I'm kind of used to medieval Latin going, we don't need that extra I.
That's true, right.
So I didn't think wings. I just thought Alice and they took out the I.
Yeah, I think that kind of contraction you probably would not see.
Okay.
Not with that I and Aliam.
That seems weird stuff. But anyway, that wings make sense. So
right.
Both with voices and with wings?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They resonated, they sang all day?
Right.
Okay. About a half an hour?
Yep.
The DU is for a long time.
Oh, for a long time, right, yeah. Right. Yeah, DU is it all day for a long time.
Okay. There's no all day. It's just...
Right. It's not all day. It's about half an hour. Okay.
Right.
Until the time when the Holy Father with his holy family and all those who were in the boat got out and sat in his tent.
Good.
This isn't all the things that were in the boat had left.
Yeah, it has to be all the things.
It's very... But of course, yeah. Yeah.
Can things get out though? Or is that why it's the Gresses? It's a weird thing with the Gresses. They took all the things out.
No, he left.
Mm-hmm.
He left with the Holy Family and all the things that were in the boat.
Right.
It can't be all the people because it's not qui, it's quai, it's neuter.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Oh, okay.
And besides, they've already covered people, the holy household.
Wait, you could have lost the egg.
That is losing the egg.
Yes, it's quai.
Quai?
Yes, right, it's qui for quai, but it's not right. Qui is
that's
the point.
Not qui. Right.
Oh, okay.
Right.
Well, except that it's agreed with omnibus, so it's not... Mm-hmm. Never mind. Okay, let's see. And when there with his attendants, he celebrated the feast of Easter, for the aforesaid procurator came to them, just as he had said before, in the lordly eighth day of Easter, carrying with him all the food that for the use in human life remained. What?
Pertained or belonged? Did you say remained or pertained?
Remained.
Pertained.
Pertained.
I think it's pertained.
Pertained. All things pertained to the use of human life. For the,
or that belong to the maintenance of human
right.
life.
And back at the beginning, the cum of cumque doesn't go with ibi. It goes with celebrasset, and when he had celebrated the Feast of Easter with his servants there, the procurator came to them, as he had said, on Die Domenico, on Sunday, the octave of Easter.
Yeah. Okay. I was wondering, William, if you might consider putting a comma
right.
after Domenico, which
right,
might make that easier.
Right. I'll put a comma there to make that easier. Bringing all food which pertain to the use of human life, for the utility of human life. Good. All right. We make progress. In case anyone cares, all of this messing around on Easter with Jasconius, the Isle of Birds, and the Isle of Sheep is at least consistent, this is where people get very excited, with the Faroe Islands, which are very close to each other. The Island of Sheep and the Faroe Islands, very close to the Island of Birds, and there's no reason to think you couldn't have a whale swimming in between them. And clearly our procurator is kind of commuting around these islands, bopping from island to island with fair ease.
Yeah, because he keeps going back and forth to and from locum suum.
Right, right. So he's all totally comfortable with that, and that's at least consistent with a group of islands which are very close to each other, as opposed, apparently, to the Azores, which are really far away from each other. Who knew? Okay, great. Thank you, Paula. Mona, 15.8.
Cum altum recedisset ad mensam, ecce predicta avis recedet in flora nauculae, extensis aliis, strepitum faciens, sicut sonitum organi magni. However, when they had sat down at the table, behold, the aforementioned bird
sat upon the prow of the little boat with wings spread out, making a noise like the sound of a great water organ. Imagine your parakeet doing that. I mean, you know, how big could this bird be? And then the man of God recognized Quia, that bird wished to tell him something.
Yep.
Excellent.
For the same bird said, God has ordained or established for you, Quattro Loca, four places at four times, understood, I guess, during the year.
Uh-huh.
Quattro Tempora. Usque dum finiantur septim ani peregrinationis vestre. Until the 7 years of your pilgrimage or peregrination be ended. Yes, that is on Maundy Thursday, Holy Thursday, with your steward who is present every year.
Good.
You will celebrate Easter on the back of the beast, the Belua. Is that specifically
I think that's the whale.
Whale, yep. Belua beast or whale? Is it specifically whale or just some kind of like big animal?
The word means beast.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But clearly it's the whale.
But it's the whale. Okay, on the back of the beast, otherwise known as Jasconius, expanded, you will celebrate Easter, with us. You will celebrate with us the Paschal feast until or up to the octave of Pentecost.
Mm-hmm. Good.
And then you will celebrate, celebrabitis, the nativity of the Lord, or Christmas, with the family or community of Elba.
Yes.
Post septem vero annos, ante cadentibus magnis at diversis periclitationibus, in venietis terram repromissionis sanctorum, but after 7 years, and this is kind of funny thing, with great antecedents, I guess that's with great events lying before you or something like that.
I think all of this goes with,
yes.
I think there are three adjectives going with paracletationibus.
I think so too.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I see. Okay. I was wondering, what the heck? It sounds like philosophy. But after 7 years with great and I guess occurring before ante cadentibus and diverse tests or trials.
Before you go on, it is actually kind of simple once you get it in the right order. With trials, yeah. Great and diverse
having preceded.
Are preceding.
And I was trying to make that into a noun so badly, I can almost taste it. Okay, with great and preceding trials, and diverse and preceding trials.
Right.
You will find in Venietis the promised land of the saints, which you are seeking. And there you will dwell for 40 days. And afterwards, God will lead you, Reduket, to the land of your birth.
Good.
The Holy Father, when he heard this, understood, prostrated himself on the ground with his own brothers, giving thanks and praise to his Creator.
Good.
When the venerable old man, or maybe elder, Sinex, had finished these things, the bird returned to his own place.
Good.
Or his whatever island he was on. So
just a different part of the island, I think.
The island, okay.
Yes.
Back to his branch.
So in 15:09, now the meal having been finished, or when the meal had been finished, the aforementioned steward then said, Deo adiuvante, with God helping, I will return to you on the day of the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the apostles, that's the same as Pentecost,
mm-hmm.
with your provisions.
Good.
Acepta benedictione, the benediction having been received, when the benediction had been received from the Holy Father and all who were with him, he returned to his place. Then the Venerable Father remained ibidem in the same place for like the aforementioned number of days, for the aforementioned days. And so the feast days having been completed, St. Brendan ordered his brothers to prepare Navidium, the ship, like or the journey, and to fill the vessels out of the spring. The boat having already been brought to the sea, behold, the aforementioned companion came to the brothers with the boat having been loaded with or burdened with food or with eats mm-hmm. for, came to the brothers with the boat having been loaded with food.
Again, as I understand it, this is the little boat that this procurator has, right? So he comes mm-hmm. with his ship loaded up with stuff to transfer to their ship.
Yep.
And when he placed all these things into the little boat of the holy man, with all the men, in other words, the monks, being embraced or being kissed, he returned whence he had come.
Good.
Can I ask a question about the form of revertar in the first line? I could not figure out the
future.
Yes.
Right.
Okay.
Future of a deponent.
Revertor. Yeah. Third
conjugation.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, third conjugation.
Third conjugation, first person singular. God, it's been a long summer.
I know.
Verb.
Yeah, it's like sequar, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, we forget our deponents. Right.
And well, but I think does reverto is that a sort of one of those what we used to call the two-faced verbs? Sometimes it's not deponent, or there are cases where it's not.
Deponent. I think that's right.
Reverto as well, isn't there?
Yes.
That sounds right now that you've said it, but that's one of those. That's another thing that happens to me. Right. If you say firmly that there is a Latin word, it'll sound right to me. Right. I've learned a lot of bad spellings grading papers that way too.
Holland
of course, medieval Latin is not that much better.
Both ways, it's okay.
Okay. So we're right in this case. Good.
Of course, medieval Latin is equal, I should think, to many students' papers for bad spelling.
That's true.
Of course, it's good on medieval standards, but it's not classical.
Like Lewis and Clark's German.
Hey, Shakespeare misspelled everything.
That's right. It.
Mm-hmm. There is no standardization of spelling until mid-19th century.
Mm-hmm. But think
that's the Webster thing.
But let's face it, the early 19th century is pretty awful. So think of the sanitation. Okay. Well done, everyone. Where are we now? Victoria.
Fish fight.
The Venerable Father, then, with his associates, with his crew, sailed on the ocean. The boat was borne for 40 days.
Mm-hmm.
But on a certain day, there appeared to them a beast of immense magnitude behind them by a long ways, mm-hmm. which bluer through foam from its nostrils and plowed a furrow through the waves, furrowed the waves with the most speedy possible course. And I translate as if they must be swallowed, as if toward swallowing them. When the brothers had seen this, they clamored, they were clamoring, to God, saying, "Spare us, Lord, lest that beast devour us." But St. Brendan comforted them, saying, "Do not fear with little faith. God, who is always our defender, will liberate us from the mouth of that beast and from other perils."
Good.
Can I do one picky, William might say, Latin teachery thing?
Yeah, sure.
First line there, navigavat in oceanum. That's in with the accusative. So that's, he actually sailed into the ocean. I take it the meaning is he sailed from the port into the ocean. Mm-hmm. But that distinction is in fact often retained, mm-hmm. even in this Latin that doesn't know how to spell itself.
Did it not sail onto the ocean?
Well, out into the ocean.
Okay.
That makes sense to me. If you're on an island, you launch your ship and you sail onto the ocean. Right?
Mm-hmm. Or into...
out of sight of land and all that stuff. The second to last line, minime fidei, if that text is right, it really, I think fidei is, I think, technically evocative, right? Don't be afraid, you minimally faithful ones. With minime as an
I took this as as vos minime fidei, ye of little faith.
Which is, of course, biblical.
Right.
Yeah.
Isn't the adjective fida
minime? Yeah, has to be the noun.
It's got to be a vos implied.
Vos, right.
Minime fidei, maybe, the adjective.
Yeah, it's from
very little faith.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, thank you, you're right. So it's the genitive of fides.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep. And I did say to William, yeah, I wondered if it should be minimi,
mm-hmm.
whether that's what the edition says or not. One of those where I'd want to go look the manuscript for that.
Well, it's definitely not that in the Selmer edition, but...
If it were minimi, how would you construe that?
Same way.
Faith.
But fides is... Well, it can't be the same way because fides is feminine.
And it's a noun.
I know what it is. Minime is probably minimi.
Right.
Has to be the adjective.
I just put that together.
That's what I'm suggesting.
Oh, sorry. Sorry. I thought you meant minimi, I with Macron, second declension.
No.
Sorry.
So sorry, we're assuming the text needs to be corrected to what?
Not exactly that it's corrected. We're just saying this is probably a case where the A is dropped, so that it's really minimi, but medieval spelling-wise, of course, it's minime, and so it's minime fidei of little faith.
Okay.
Right. Thank you. That's much better all around.
Oh, ye of little faith. Okay.
Good. I did want to, despite all of our nasty remarks about medieval Latin, notice they do get that gerundive with a verb of motion expressing purpose, right? He mm-hmm. went with them. Ad illos devorandos is really good classical Latin for the purpose, literally the purpose of them getting devoured. Right, for the purposes of...
Them having to be eaten, yeah.
And there he's quite consistent about his gerundives, it seems to me. Mm-hmm. All right, good. Victoria, keep going. 16.2.
But when he had approached near to them, the waves were preceding of marvelous, miraculous height up to the boat.
Good.
While, Dumtaxit, the brothers at that time were more and more fearing.
Good.
And the venerable old man said, with his hands extended to heaven, Lord, liberate your servants, just as you liberated David from the hand of the giant Goliath. Lord, free us, just as you freed Jonah from the belly of the great whale.
Good. Bruce, you had a comment about Dumtaxat.
I think that comes to be a kind of pseudo-enclitic with not a whole lot of meaning. It's something like quidem or certe or something like that.
Okay.
And if so, it might start a new sentence.
Mm-hmm.
And, oh boy, the brothers were more and more afraid.
Okay, thanks.
Possible. Don't know. Couldn't find Dumtaxit meaning while.
Right.
Which is what made me think of this more sort of quidem certe kind of thing.
Okay. If you've got some good examples of that, let me know. All right. We don't have a volunteer for this the last section, is that right?
No, we have Jen.
Yeah, this was the part I signed up for.
Oh, okay. All right, Jen, take it away.
So 16:3, with these three verses having been finished, behold, a huge beast was crossing near to them from the west to meet the other beast. And it immediately started a war against it in such a way that it had sent out fire from its mouth.
Mm-hmm.
But indeed, the old man said to his brothers, see, little sons, the great deeds of our Redeemer. See the obedience of the beast to their creator,
This is, I think this is not the same thing as what we call a dragonfish, is that right?
I didn't know there was a dragonfish.
Mm-mm. I think this is one of those tropical fish that people keep in aquariums.
Fits fire.
It suggested that these are walruses.
Spitting fire.
Which apparently do fight.
But don't breathe fire.
No.
I don't think they can make waves big enough to
swamp the boat. Yeah.
I'm just saying. Keep going, Jen.
Okay. Now wait for the end of the affair. For this fight brings nothing bad to you. Like, nothing bad is going to happen to you because of this fight, in other words. But for the glory of God, it'll be inscribed to the glory of God, or it'll give glory to God. With these things having been said, the wretched beast, which was pursuing the servants of Christ, was killed into three parts in front of them.
Like Gaul.
The other beast returned after its victory whence it had come.
Good.
But on another day, they saw an island far off, really woody and pretty. And with them approaching to the shore of the same island, of the island itself, and having disembarked and disembarking from their boat, they saw the end part of that beast which had been killed. St. Brendan said, look, it's the beast which wanted to devour us. You all will devour it. You will wait for a long time on this island. Therefore, raise your little boat higher in onto the land and look for a place in that forest where it is possible for your shelter to stand.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Father himself had picked out a spot for them to live in.
Good.
And there we go.
Okay. Can I? Yeah. I was going to ask why it's the posterior of the beast, but we can maybe talk about that next week. We're all getting a little punchy.
You mean?
Is there any significance to being the hind, you know, the end with the tail?
It would be a fairly meaty portion, wouldn't it? I mean, narrative-wise, it would make sense.
Was that a clever Socratic question, Bruce, that you have an answer? Or you...
No, absolutely. I don't know how to do that.
No, okay.
You know, I think some of the things that we think are significant here might actually not be as significant as we think they might be. They might just be sort of details, if I can borrow a somewhat irrelevant quotation, intended to give verisimilitude to an otherwise bald and unconvincing narrative.
Maybe. Yeah. Although, again, divided.
Not that I know whether this is being made up or not. I don't know the intentions of the author.
That sounds kind of like giving up, though, if you just say, oh, well, it's, you know, not an important detail. I mean,
in
a literary text should have...
Yes, but I mean, it needn't be symbolic. It can be a part of the story, a part of the plot, a part of, you know, creating the atmosphere of wherever they are without necessarily having a spiritual meaning for every individual detail.
Well, I think there are too many details for this to be complete fantasy. I mean, if you read something like Moby Dick, there's equally florid language about whales, but Herman Melville knew his whaling because he had actually... have been on a whaler for like 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
And he made most of his writing career writing about all the crazy stuff he did when he was on this, well, going all around the world hunting whales.
Right. See, that's what I'm thinking, is details needn't have a symbolic value to have a value. I certainly do think that a lot of these details do have symbolic value. I'm just arguing that we need to keep in the back of our minds the possibility that some of these details have a narrative value of, you know, creating the atmosphere, giving us a sense of reality as
right.
to the narrative.
I would invoke that for the as an answer to Bruce's question about why the hind part of the beast. I think the division into three doesn't have to be Christian symbolism exactly, but clearly our author, there are certain numbers that our author uses a lot, right? He uses 3, mm-hmm. he uses 40, he uses, I guess he uses octave too, but maybe that's not the same, but certainly 3 and 40 come out, you know, everything is 3 and 40 pretty much. I should make a collection of all the numbers to see. So I don't think, So whether that makes the three, dividing the beast into three Christian symbolism or not, I'm not sure, but it's certainly, that's not verisimilitude, it seems to me. You know, if it were divided into 5 parts, then I'd be interested, mm-hmm. right? But I agree about the tail of the fish, on the other hand. So, I don't know.
Well, three is extremely ancient in Indo-European thought. I mean,
right.
It predates Christianity by a healthy margin.
Right.
And it could simply, I mean, think of how people tend to divide an animal in their minds in the most basic way. It's the head, it's the body, and it's the tail. That's
mm-hmm.
three. But there's no
right.
real symbolism
right.
to
it's
it.
It's just part of
our brains are wired.
It's just part
yeah.
of our minds.
Yeah, it's just the way, it's our. It's a cultural or a way we're wired or whatever. It's just the way we think. And there is no conscious symbolism going on.
Unless it's just the randomness of aquatic roadkill. You know, you just get torn into 3 pieces.
Or maybe if you chop up a whale into pieces, On the ocean, the tail floats the longest and is therefore the most likely to wash up on the shore. I
really wouldn't know.
I think it depends on the whale.
Are there any latter-day Melvilles out there that care to
I think Melville might give us some inspiration, because there's all that whole, you know, part of the book is about, you know, cutting up the whale and what they do with the lard and this, that, and the other. It's very precise and fine. Yeah. That might provide some insight here.
I think it depends on the whale. If it's a baleen whale or if it's a right whale. A right whale, yeah.
Of course, if they've got
oil in the head, I think that might be lighter. Mm-hmm.
Of course, there's also the question, how much did our author know about whales and whaling?
Right.
Mm-hmm. No. Probably a fair, you'd be surprised. Well, Ireland did a fair bit of opportunistic cutting up of whales when they beached.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but don't forget, he's also the person who tells us that the whale is mistaken for an island. So, I mean,
and that people can camp out on it.
Really big island. Sure. So anyway, on that cheerful note, class, I think we should all go home and go to bed. Thanks again, everyone.
I think so too.
Thanks especially for pitch hitting, translating, and maybe see you guys next week.
Okay.
I think it's getting more interesting. It gets more interesting.
Definitely.
It's very interesting. This is a really fun text to do. I'm glad we're doing it.
Oh, I'm glad you're liking it. That's great. All right, good night, everyone. Take care.
Good night.
Thanks, everyone. Good night.
Good night.
Valete omnes.